Hello everyone, thank you for joining Family Caregiver Alliance for today's webinar on Harvesting the Spiritual Fruits of Caregiving as a Way to Cultivate Wellness, presented by Marcia Wiener and Andrea Sherman. This webinar is open to caregivers and professionals. CEUs are available through the Board of Behavioral Sciences. In order to obtain your continuing education credit, please email adugai@caregiver.org with your name and license number or other ID number. I am AJ Dugai, the Education Coordinator for Family Caregiver Alliance. Let me give you a little background on our organization. For over 35 years, we've been working through the Bay Area and across the nation to improve the well-being of family caregivers that are providing long-term care. We offer support through educational classes, workshops, fact sheets, retreats, caregiver support services, research, caregiver advocacy, and more. For more information, please visit us at www.caregiver.org. For the duration of the presentation, your phones will be muted. If you have any questions, you may ask them throughout by going to the GoToMeeting question box on your screen. These questions will be answered at the end of the presentation. Please have a pencil and paper readily available to participate in some of the interactive segments of this webinar. After the completion of this webinar, you will be sent an email with a survey. Your feedback is very important to us in shaping our future education program, so we would like to thank you in advance for filling those out. Today's speakers are Marcia Wiener and Andrea Sherman, who are the founders of Transitional Keys and Seasons of Care. Andrea is a gerontologist, public speaker, and choreographer. Marcia is trained as a hospital chaplain and in mindfulness-based stress reduction meditation. Without further ado, I'll now turn things over to Marcia and Andrea.
Thank you, Adrian, very much. We want to thank Family Caregiver Alliance for the opportunity to be with you today and for all of you who have chosen to join with us for Seasons of Care, Harvesting the Spiritual Fruits of Caregiving as a Way to Cultivate Wellness, Contemplative and Expressive Art. Our objectives for this webinar are to understand the value of spiritual practice for wellness, to identify some spiritual fruits that are inherent in caregiving, to explore two practices to cultivate spiritual fruits using the contemplative and expressive arts, and to create opportunities to strengthen caring moments and to rekindle joy. We chose this slide and a quote from one of my favorite books called The Caregiver's Tao Te Ching, which was written by William and Nancy Martin. Each of them were family caregivers for their aging parents. They were also steeped in a contemplative practice of Zen meditation, and they were volunteers for hospice care. And they wrote this lovely folio called The Caregiver's Tao Te Ching, which poetically describes the caregiver's very uneven journey, all of those ups and downs that we go through. And one quote that we suggest that we drove here for our unifying statement for the webinar was how to honor ourselves. We honor ourselves by caring for others, and we honor others by caring for ourselves. And we chose this because it conveys that as caregivers, we really need to strike a balance between caring for others and taking care for ourselves. It becomes like an ecosystem. And all ecosystems have a dynamic for seeking balance. And we need to seek this balance so that we can accomplish what we want to, which is to deliver the best care possible. Because if we don't seek a balance, then burnout is, you know, relatively inevitable, even though there are some studies coming out, like there was a recent one from Johns Hopkins, which says that there can be some modest longevity awards for caregiving. Regardless, those of us who are caregivers know that if caregiving becomes too task-driven, it can lead to burnout, which has been characterized as withdrawal from family and friends, a loss of interest in things that otherwise engaged us with life, feeling blue and irritable and hopeless, feeling emotionally and physically exhausted, angry, sad, and frustrated, neglecting our personal health, and ensure all the spectrum of depression. So we're told to counteract this burnout. Eat well. She didn't sleep. We take her own doctor's appointment. Interesting is that all of these very well-intentioned and very, very, well and good suggestions, but they're all about taking care of the physical body. But through our work with students of care, the driving inquiry has been, but what about the inner life of the caregiver? What about, aside from the physical body, taking care of that, is there a role of spirituality and wellness, and is that applicable for caregivers? And we found out that the role of spirituality and wellness is a very lively field of interest. And we uncovered a lot of insight about how spirituality is applicable for wellness for caregivers. And here's one quote that we uncovered. Caregivers who use religious or spiritual beliefs to cope with caregiving had a better relationship with care recipients, back to that ecosystem between caregiver and care recipient, which was associated with lower levels of depression and role subversion. So it begs the question of, okay, what's spirituality, which is a very broad, big as the sky term, and there is no singular definition. But there are, at least in Western culture, there are some shared roots of the word, which are air and wind and the breath that gives life. And other words that are associated are inspiration or meaning, transcendence. They're all rather ephemeral, kind of like music and the expressive arts. So to address the inner life of caregivers, we turn to the contemplative and expressive arts, which are ephemeral in nature, but have deep and long and ancient roots in trying to understand the human condition. So we explore and have worked with caregivers and how to use these contemplative and expressive arts as a way to cultivate wellness for caregivers. And in the process, I personally collided with this quote that's often been attributed to a Catholic friar, the St. Francis of Assisi. I'm not a Catholic, I'm not a Christian, but this quote really, to me, framed what we were seeking to find out when it says, for it is in the giving that we receive. So, it begs the question, what is it that we receive? Are there spiritual fruits inherent in caregiving? It's in the giving that we receive. So I'd like us at this point to, if we could, take a moment for a very short contemplative moment. Rest in your chair. If you're sitting at your desk, if you're sitting in your couch with your laptop, to sit comfortably in your chair with your feet relaxed on the floor, your hands, your arms relaxed on a tabletop or in your lap. And exhale, have your eyes closed or open, or just relax your eyelids. Turn your attention inside with a suggestion of just the inquiry, reflecting on your own experiences from having been a caregiver, from being a caregiver. Do you have a sense, can you feel, how has it impacted your internal life? How have you grown spiritually? Have the experiences you've had from as being a caregiver presented you with unique insights about yourself? Maybe you can't articulate them, but you feel them, you sense them, you know them as being true. could there be, are there some spiritual fruits that you've been able to harvest and integrate into your life as you move forward with your life from being a caregiver? If you've encountered these spiritual fruits, just jot them down. As AJ asked, you have some pencil and paper nearby. Jot down the spiritual fruits you think you've encountered. And now I'm going to toss it over to Andrea.
Hi, everyone. Greetings. And it's wonderful to be here today. And I saw a few names that I know. So hello to you all. And this is a slide from, it's actually some of the spiritual fruits from the New Testament. And it says goodness, joy, kindness, patience, gentleness. And this is from the New Testament. And perhaps some of these fruits were on your list. I know gentleness was on mine. I'm sure there were others. If we were all in the same room, we would chatter now about what are the spiritual fruits that we've experienced. But I would imagine that some of these on this list are on yours. This is the list that Marcia and I developed based on the work that we've been doing with caregivers. And our spiritual fruits of caregiving includes contentment, presence, acceptance, joy, compassion, clarity, kindness, intimacy, resilience, and well-being. For example, I was a caregiver to my mother at the very end of her life, and the spiritual fruit that we experienced together was intimacy, probably more intimacy than I ever had experienced with her in my life, as I was holding her in my arms and singing to her and rocking to her, and just the incredible tenderness and intimacy and being there together as she died. Perhaps, though, your caregiving has given you a sense of contentment, a sense of purpose through caring, I think, which is very key. A lot of the literature talks about meaning and purpose in caregiving. Currently, I'm helping a really good friend of mine and her 90-year-old mother who recently fell. And I feel a very strong sense of contentment. It's actually like a dual sense of contentment because I'm caring for my friend's mother, Pearl, and then I'm caring for my friend, Marika. So it's really caregiving to both mother and daughter. In caregiver burnout, there is an erosion of wellness. Just to kind of indulge our horticulture metaphor here, caregiver burnout can erode our sense of wellness. Seasons of care, though, through the contemplative and expressive arts, through these practices, cultivates the soil of wellness. And our focus is on wellness, and it's a focus on strength as well as problems, and on finding positive emotions which can help us with a sense of coping with strength, confidence, and good health. So we literally have to roll our sleeves up and dig into the dirt somewhat. So the challenge here, and it is indeed a challenge, is to move from a state of distress to a state of well-being with meaning and purpose, and to achieve that sense of balance, of that large elephant balancing on that small ball. We realizing that caregiver distress is not a single event. It's a mix. It's a mix of circumstances and experiences and responses. And we know that the mix is not stable. It's been called a roller coaster, and that when there's a change in one component, it result in a change in others. So to move from stress and the strain of caregiving to harvesting the spiritual fruits and experiencing the sense of wellness to offset the imbalances and distress of caregiving How do we do that? What's the process? Well, we think one way to do that is through practice. Yes. And that having spiritual practices is what can help us to achieve balance and harvest the spiritual fruits that are inherent in caregiving. We know the value of the contemplative and the expressive arts, and that's the practices that we suggest can help as an antidote to caregiver burnout. And that there's well-documented evidence about stress reduction, an improved immune system, increased self-awareness, enhanced personal relationships, and an overall more reflective environment. Our good friend Julia Raleigh, who's an expressive artist, suggests that through the expressive arts we can access, release, and transform those stressful emotions that impede the function of the immune system and diminish the relaxation response. The expressive arts, which can include a variety of modalities like movement, writing, theater, music, and story, can help us to access, release, and transform stressful emotions. When we make art, we can access images from our intuition and wisdom through this expression. And that can help us to increase and enhance and strengthen our immune system. Through creative expression, art can bring out our inner healer, and this can give us new insights into life. In the contemplative arts research, more than 20 years of studies reveal that both meditative and contemplative practices can aid in relieving the symptoms of burnout, depression, anxiety, insomnia, and a weakened immune system. And these practices strengthen our resiliency. So there is ample evidence about both the expressive and contemplative arts. This is an example from the NIH Clinical Center Caregiver Day in 2011. And on one side, you see caregivers participating in a visual arts experience. And not only are they making art, but they're also sharing stories. On the other side, they're having a contemplative arts experience through seated massage and through restoration and renewal. I'm going to turn it over to Marcia now.
So we're going to break out now the expressive and contemplative arts, and I'll talk a bit about the expressive arts and then toss it back to Andrea for the contemplative. And as it was mentioned, as we know, there are many, many modalities of expressive arts: drawing, writing, singing, art making, dancing, music making. And there's this wonderful quote I find from Kurt Vonnegut, who says, to practice any art, no matter how well or how badly, is a way to make your soul grow. So do it. And what he's inviting us to do is to dive in, not to not be judgment, not have a goal, not to have we're not trying to be professional artists, but just use the tools that are available to us to simply go for that soul growth. And for me, one of the primary tools of the expressive arts is color. And here's that incredible spectrum, which if you look at it in one level, kind of looks like an eye, but not one color eye, but the eye of all of the colors of light being refracted against surfaces, which is what color is. But as caregivers, I think we should recognize that we are natural colorists. After all, we're always paying attention to the, even consciously or unconsciously, to the color of the skin, to the nails, to the tongue, to the toes, to the eyes, to the general visage or complexion of the person that we're caring for. We get information and clues about their general health, their inner well-being. We get a lot of information about color. So we're attenuated to color even if we're not aware of it. And what I found was interesting in exploring the expressive arts, especially with color, is that we're attuned to it, and on the level of culture and society, there are different values attributed to color, which are oftentimes contradictory. So I thought if we could kind of explode the general values attributed to color, we can then make color our own, and we can make our own dictionary of color. For example, here's the color blue, which is usually attributed as being a very cool color. Here are some of the contradictions that are given to the color blue. If you're a first place winner, you get a blue ribbon. But if you're feeling down in the dumps, you sing the blues. As caregivers, it's very often times, I know for myself, that when I feel down, but if it's a sunny day, and I look up and there's a blue sky, I feel uplifted. Then there's the color yellow. I don't know why I have to confess that yellow is my favorite color. I know that it's in the automobile industry, they paint fewer cars yellow than any other color. It's my favorite color. Psychologically, it's attributed as being the happiest color. At the same time, yellow is given the cultural color of being quarantined. And you can see it if you walk down the street and there's a crime scene. That yellow and black tape, yellow is quarantined. What's interesting to me exploring the color yellow is if someone is accused of being yellow-bellied, it means they're a coward. But in certain Native American Indian tribes, when they had war paint on their face, yellow signified that a warrior was willing to fight to his death, contrary to being a coward. And here's red. We know red is often attributed to being fire and passion. In our idioms, if we're given the red carpet treatment, it means we're treated very, very well. We should feel pretty good. However, if one is red-faced, it means they're embarrassed, or blushing, or angry. If it's a red letter day, it's a day to be remembered. However, if you are caught red-handed, it means you are guilty. Probably a day you least want to remember. And then there's black, the no color color. It's interesting. People think black is a heavy color. The study where there is a box made of a black paper and white paper, the exact same weight of paper. Everyone thought the black box weighed heavier than the white box. What's interesting is that we wear black because we want to look slimmer and lighter. And also in society, a black day is a grim day. At the same day, same time, if you're invited to a black tie event, it's one of a lot of glamour and hopefully fun, contrary to being grim. And then there's white, which is, fantastically interesting in that in some cultures, people wear black as the color of mourning. And Eastern cultures, they wear white to honor their dead. White can be empty. It can be full. It can be a surface for reflection. So here is a painterly version of colors. Not every color. There's no aqua. There's no real orange. But I thought we'd present you with this painterly display of color. And again, if you could get comfortable in your chair in a somewhat contemplative position with your eyes open to behold of the colors, with your spine straight but not stiff, your eyes open so you can view the colors. Think about if I was to ask you, is there any color there, if I say the word compassion, that your eyes, your heart, your mind may decide to focus on? Or joy? Is there a different color? That might register with you. Or sadness. Or how do you feel right now? And if you think about resiliency, as a caregiver, we all know what it means. We need to feel resilient. Is there a color or colors that you resonate with that are your colors of resiliency? Any of the reds, any of the yellows, any of the blues? Could be a silver. And there are some simple daily color practices that we can integrate into our lives. It's interesting. I know that a reporter, Helen Thomas, who I think she just passed away a couple of years ago. She was in her 90s. She said she always wore a red suit as she sat in the front row at the White House briefing room to make sure she was seen to be recognized. So there are power colors. There are colors for resilience, comfort. Picasso went through a blue period. He also went through a rose period. What period can we go through for resilience? Can you go through for resilience? During your day, you can doodle in the color, your colors of resilience. Wear those colors. Have a charm of those colors in your pocket. Flowers of those colors. Look for those colors. It's always amazing where you'll find them. We can write our own dictionary, our own colors of resilience color card. There's a wonderful children's book written by Leo Leone, used to be a kindergarten teacher, called Frederick, and Frederick was a mouse. And Frederick's mouse family was busy getting ready for the winter, and all the mice were busy collecting straw to build beds and seeds and nuts. And Frederick was just sitting out there soaking up the last light of the sun and the colors of the flowers and the colors of the birds and the sounds of the birds and the colors of the grass. And when he and his mice family were hibernating for the winter, and they were all in their mouse home, and they got a little cabin fever. And then Frederick stepped forward, and he began to speak poetry, the poetry of color, and the color of blue, and what the color of the sky was like, and the color of the reds and the yellows. And the illustration in the book was this little mouse with the bubble thought above him was just the palette of color. And we can do that for ourselves in the day. We can draw upon our own power of the colors, which is against the sometimes often bleak landscape that the colors that we're having to deal with as caregivers. And with that, I toss it back to Andrea for the contemplative arts.
Well, I confess, everyone, that purple is my favorite color. And I've loved purple for as long as I can remember, maybe since age 3 or 4 even. So please join me for a moment as we transition to the contemplative arts, and be aware of your breath, especially your exhale. So take a good deep breath in and exhale out with a sigh. And the breath is very key in the contemplative arts, in meditation, in prayer, in poetry, contemplation, and mindfulness. In all of these, the breath is a tool that we rely on. The contemplative arts really can increase our capacity for insight, for deep concentration, for calm, for peacefulness and openness, and also to help us develop greater empathy and communication skills. And I think calmness and peacefulness are wonderful qualities to cultivate as a caregiver. This is a quote from Rachel Naomi Remen. I'm sure some of you are familiar with her work. She is in California and runs Commonweal. And she says, helping, fixing, and serving represent three different ways of seeing life. When you help, you see life as weak. When you fix, you see life as broken. When you serve, you see life as whole. Accepting a person where they are without trying to fix them can be a challenge, but it promotes empathy, not sympathy. And I think this sense of empathy, the perspective of another person, and not judging them, recognizing emotion in others and communicating that, feeling a sense of sacred space. I think when you serve, there is that sense of sacred space. Being able to say, I know what it's like down here, and you are not alone. Empathy is a very vulnerable choice. Brené Brown, who has done much work about gratitude and joy, supports our idea that practicing the contemplative and the expressive arts is what yields fruit. She is best known for her research around vulnerability, courage, worthiness, and shame. Originally, she thought that if someone was joyful, then they would be grateful. But actually, her research revealed that her assumption was wrong, and she discovered the reverse of that, that if someone was grateful, then they experienced joy, that if we practice gratitude, we can increase the joy in our lives. And this is different from an attitude of gratitude. It's a practice. It includes gratitude journals, meditation, prayers, and art. It's a very tangible practice that can support you as a caregiver and increase your joy and overall well-being. You can choose to practice gratitude any time of the day, to just stop and say, I am grateful for. So I think this is a very deep insight for caregivers, being able to practice gratitude. So, take a moment, and this is an interactive exercise, two different gratitude practices. So right now, this very moment, think of one thing that you are grateful for and say it out loud. I'm grateful for warmer weather. Just say it. You can do this simple present moment gratitude practice during your day. Perhaps when you first wake up, you can take a moment and reflect on what you're grateful for, or maybe at lunch, or when you're walking the dog, or before bedtime. Very, very simple. Now, raise your 10 fingers, like the hands that we see against the sky. Hold up your hands. And on each big finger, name what you are grateful for. I'm grateful for music, good food, my dog, the Hudson River that I see every day, friends, the color purple, springtime, a good hot shower, dancing, and sharing this experience with you today. So this is a very simple 10-finger gratitude exercise. and we encourage you to do this once a day. Because gratitude invites joy. It's not joy that makes us grateful. It is gratitude that makes us joyful. And this is a quote from Brother David Stendhal Rast. Gratitude, it seems, is a key. It's a key to feeling more satisfied with your life. Strengthening your sense of joy and social connection, gratitude can improve relationships and help you cope with adversity and even fortify your immune system. Master Eckhart said, if the only prayer you say in your whole life is thank you, that would suffice. So another way, if the word gratitude doesn't connect for you, is to say, I appreciate, and to do the same 10-finger appreciation exercise. This sense of thankfulness, gratitude, and appreciation is key to joy and well-being. In her book, Thrive, Arianna Huffington asks if gratitude can help you thrive. And we think that gratitude can not only help you thrive, but that it can help you to experience the spiritual fruits of caregiving. I like this tree. It's the tree of contemplative practices. And it's from the Center for Contemplative Mind and Society. If you go to that web address on the bottom, you can see it. And you can have a totally blank copy to make your own contemplative practices, or this one. And the tree highlights what some of these contemplative practices are that you can do. You can do stillness practices, like silence, centering prayer, or sitting meditation, or movement practices, tai chi, yoga, maybe labyrinth walking, or creation process practices, singing, chanting, contemplative music, sand mandalas, ritual practices, which Marsha and I like and have done a lot of, ceremonies and rituals, building a shrine, or relational practices, deep listening, storytelling, journaling. And the relational practice relates to the idea of the caring moment or the caring occasion. And this is based on nurse educator Jean Watson's work. And you, as a caregiver, become aware of the present moment with the person that you are caring for. There is an occasion of caring that is shared in a human interaction that is interconnected and transformative. And the contemplative arts, having a contemplative practice, can help you be more open to the present moment. And this present moment can become a caring moment or a caring occasion.
It's me, it's Marsha. I'm back with the Expressive Arts. And here is this beautiful painting, I hope you agree it's beautiful, of a door. It looks like a door to me. And when we get to do these presentations live, there's a lot more art that we get to make and do and explore together. But I could not include this image in this disembodied webinar because I think the door is such a strong symbol. I mean, as caregivers, there are so many entries and exits, comings and goings, in and out of the door, that the door is really a theatrical prop, can become a theatrical prop. When you open and close, you enter and exit. If you're present, it's an opportunity for me to remind myself to be present. Personally, my 92-year-old father is blind due to macular degeneration and can't process what he hears because of his dementia. And I've had to learn through truly my own contemplative practice and using the expressive arts, and I have to be open that I have no idea what I'm going to, where he's going to be when I go see him when I open the door. So I have to be in the moment with an open heart. I've had to use these contemplative and expressive arts practices, and oftentimes I believe that it's because of, that sounds too boorish, but because of practice that we can be open to surprises and to some really wonderful surprises. And one surprise that greeted me was a couple of weeks ago I went to see my dad, who I've had to put in a home because it became too dangerous, since he was a night wanderer, and having a 90-year-old, you know, blind man with dementia wandering around the streets of Baltimore City, it was not a good thing to do. So when I went to see him a couple of weeks ago, I went through the door of the building, went towards the elevator, and as the elevator door opened, there was a woman in the elevator who, a woman from the Cameroon, who was obviously, she worked at the home, and she was in her scrubs in her work shift. And when I went into the elevator and the door closed, I realized she was humming a song that Doris Day made famous in the 1950s, Que Sera, Sera. Well, I knew the words. So rather than being wrapped up in my own angst about my dad, I started to sing. And I have a terrible singing voice. When I was just a little girl. And this woman from the Cameroon knew the words as well as the melody. And so we're singing, "Ah, yes, my mother, what would I be?" As the elevator rose up and the doors opened on the third floor, where I had to get out before she, to the chorus, "Que sera, sera. Whatever will be." And that moment for me as a caregiver was as poignant as it was wise. And it made me feel grateful for being able to be there for my dad and to be open to the moment with the caregiver in the elevator as we all say, "Que sera, sera."
Whatever will be, I think is a great caregiving motto. I mean, it really launches you into the present moment. Whatever will be. So if you could take a moment and just say that out loud to yourself or even think it inside, that would be great. So we're going to summarize, give a few more examples, and then open up to questions and answers and discussion. So caregiving truly requires a balance between caring for ourselves and caring for others, just like that original quote suggested. We can harvest the spiritual fruits of caregiving through the contemplative and the expressive arts practices. Spirituality, indeed, can serve as an antidote to caregiver burnout and stress, and it can increase and enhance the meaning and purpose of our caregiving. The practice of contemplative and expressive arts can strengthen the immune system and relieve depression, anxiety, and insomnia. And gratitude practice strengthens joy and resilience. Another set of practices that we think are really helpful, we've named gap practices, because one of the challenges as caregivers that we face is finding the time to practice. And we'd like to suggest that you can do 2-minute practices and find the gap to practice throughout your day. One practice that Marsha alluded to we call open sky. And that is taking a moment and just stopping wherever you are, whatever time it is, and just looking up at the sky and feeling the spaciousness of the sky and the spaciousness of the moment. And that open sky practice can restore you. It helps create new space and more space around you. Another practice is the doorway practice, and taking a moment before you enter the door, whether it's a real door or just the entryway into caregiving, taking a moment before the entrance of your caring moment, your caring occasion, and taking a moment to center yourself and to let go of any judging that you may have, any agenda that you may be bringing with you, any sense of fixation on any ideas about what you think this caregiving interaction should be, and just letting go and being present as you enter the door. And then when you leave, taking a moment for yourself, creating some sort of neutral space, some space that is not filled with all of your caregiving demands, tasks, and emotions. That transitional time is really important. That clear space is a practice. It's a gap practice. For some time, I was a hospice volunteer, and I had a really hard time leaving hospice and then getting on the subway in New York. It was just like, it was a very difficult transition. And I was in a program, and the supervisor said, as soon as you press the elevator button to leave that hospice, you have to let go. You have to let go. You have to not get on your telephone and just be incredibly mindful. So I think mindfulness awareness is a practice when you enter and when you exit. Another practice that Marcia mentioned, which I've heard her do many times, is humming. And humming is really good. It breaks up whatever momentum you may have in terms of thinking or worrying or anxiety or stress. And humming aloud, I think it's like it puts the sound out there, and it helps to dissolve some of the stresses and strains of caregiving. So humming. And a fourth practice, and this I think is a lot easier to teach in a group, is what I would call a venting practice. Sometimes as caregivers, there's nothing that we can do except vent. And I don't think venting is so bad. There are times when venting is really helpful. So one practice is just to be able to vent for a few minutes. Give yourself 30 seconds and vent. Let it go. Let it out. Just say what you have to say. Call a friend. You know, whatever it is, sometimes you have to vent. So, and I think there are different attitudes towards venting, but I know it's worked for me, particularly calling a friend. There is a practice we've taught with caregivers where you actually take a balloon, and on the balloon you write what it is you want to vent. What do you want to let go of? What's the emotion? Maybe it's anger. Maybe it's real sadness over what's going on. And then taking a pin and popping the balloon and just letting the air out of it, trying to not make it so big, you know, decrease the impact of it. So these gap practices of open sky, the doorway, humming, vent, and venting are good gap practices. So we want to thank you. Here are some resources for you. The Caregivers Tao Te Ching, a series of meditations that we've recorded for audio called Seasons of Care, Jon Kabat-Zinn's Full Catastrophe Living, Brené Brown's book on the gifts of imperfection. You can also catch her on YouTube, and a mindfulness bibliography prepared by the Mindfulness Awareness Research Center. And here's some information on Family Caregiving Alliance, which I'll go back to. And then also, you can follow Seasons of Care. You can follow us on Twitter at Seasons of Care, where we have daily inspirations, tips, and ideas for caregivers. So we want to thank all of you for attending today, and thank Family Caregivers Alliance for their sponsorship. And now I'm going to turn it back over to AJ.
Thank you both so much. That was really helpful information, and it was a refreshing approach on how to take care of yourself as a caregiver, and a reminder that it only takes a couple minutes to practice that. So we do have some time for questions, and I'll read those off now. So we have a question from Wendy. She says, I have just come home from caring for a friend of mine I have known for 42 years, and she is dying of cancer. What it took for me to fly across the country this year was an act of truly showing up to honor the love we have shared. It was an act of saying goodbye. In the process of being with her over the days, I realize all the ways that most people avoid dropping into that necessary state of presence that it takes to caregive. The slowness of intimacy. Can you speak to why people can be so resistant to truly dropping into the reflective and contemplative states that you are describing?
That's a great question. I guess I'll start, and then Marcia,
if you want to add in.
Sure. You know, I think it really, that kind of intimacy, and that's the right word for it, that intimacy is so deep that people, I think, are afraid in their hearts to make that kind of connection. Because for you, Wendy, it was such a deep, rich experience. And I think part of it, I'll be honest, I think part of it is attitudes towards death and dying, where there are so many negative attitudes about what that's like. And as someone that did a year working with people that were dying recently, it's a practice, and it's a deep practice, and it puts you face to face with your own mortality, which can be frightening. So, and obviously you weren't frightened by it, but I think it's, you know, it's because death and dying and our attitudes towards death and dying are so negative, just like they are about growing older. So, Marcia, do you want to add anything?
Well, I think it's just, Wendy, it was wonderful. Thank you for sharing your experience, and I think everyone on this call can recognize that, you know, it's fear. It's fear that keeps us from going inside about all sorts of things, let alone mortality. You know, fear is a mighty force, and it takes courage to sit, and the contemplative practices cultivate that courage so that we can get through all sorts of fears for a variety of freedoms that we don't even know or are aware of because fear keeps us blind.
Thank you so much. We have another question from Valerie. She said, many parents of vulnerable adult children with complex developmental disabilities live in abject and realistic fear that their own mortality and the well-being of their children when they are gone. The under-resourced system of support is at the heart of this. Gratitude does help in the moment, but doesn't address the bigger issues around long-term support and well-being of loved ones. Big needs here that deserve attention and support. So I guess she just wanted to share that with you guys.
And that's a political will, and that's a collective challenge of where's the collective will of society in our community to galvanize the resources so that when your child becomes an adult and the children that we love who have those challenges are cared for. And I appreciate that you share that, and that's where, you know, a collective practice can have some force.
Yeah. And then I have another question. Do you find that these wellness tools are helpful to all cultures?
Yes. And although our presentation is secular in nature, all cultures have expressive arts practices of music, dance, singing, and there are contemplative practices across cultures as well. And some of these are the same and some are different. But for me, I think the contemplative and the expressive arts are languages. They're both languages. They're tools. And those tools cut across cultural differences. They can. I've seen it, you know, where I've taught meditation to people of many different cultures, and then although it may feel very different to some people, eventually it's been my experience that particularly caregivers are very open to them. And it may be called something else. It might look something, you know, different in another culture. But I think the contemplative and the expressive arts are tools that cut across all cultures.
Thank you. Okay, so I have another question. In times of hardship, it is really difficult to maintain that spirituality. How do you suggest to deal with that?
Well, you know, no doubt. I mean, every caregiver is in a time of hardship. And I didn't mean to sound, you know, glib, but having, you know, live it. And I think how you deal with it is you give yourself a break and you take a breath. And that's where you start. And I think it is an act of courage oftentimes to just say, okay, I'm going to take this break. I'm going to take this breath for myself. And it goes back to our starting point about balance. And we know that not to diminish at all, how tough and how hard and how dark and how bleak things can appear. But there is a moment you can take to take that breath to begin to seek your balance, and then you can move on.
And I really believe in respite. If people can get respite, I think it's really key to take time away from caregiving. You know, it's a practice to take time away and to take a break, but to be able to make that happen for yourself is a real gift to be able to give to yourself. And I think it's really important to replenish and to restore, because especially if you have either very intensive caregiving or very long-term caregiving, and you know, sometimes we use the image of the gas tank, and it's good to keep your gas tank above half so that you don't burn out. I think it's a preventative practice, and, you know, sometimes you can't look for the long haul of it. It has to be a daily or getting through the next hour kind of practice, because it can be overwhelming. So I don't know if anyone out there has any practices that you do, or if there's a way for us to hear of any specific contemplative or expressive arts practices that people that are participating have.
Yeah, if anyone wanted to send that in, that's okay. Well, that's about all the time we have for questions. It's been such a pleasure to collaborate with you guys on this webinar. Mm-hmm. Thank you to everyone who has participated. Feel free to call us if you have any questions at 800-445-8106. Again, you will receive a survey in your email, and we'd really appreciate your feedback to shape our future programs. Thank you so much.
And we want to hear your feedback, too.
Yeah. Thank you, Marcia and Andrea, for joining us today.
Thank you all.
Thank you.
Okay.
Bye. Thank you all.
This webinar is now concluded.